Welcome back. Music Unapologetically. Host Adam, co-host Travis. What's been going on, dude? It has been months since we've sat in this chair together in front of these mics. And I'm glad to be here. And I'm glad you're here.
I'm glad to be here with you.
Yeah.
Life's busy.
Yeah, life is super busy.
I know you've had a lot of stuff going on.
Yeah, a lot of stuff going on, especially with the boy. Riley's playing football. It's going great. He loves it. It's something like Riley, he almost didn't, I don't know. Riley's never been a fan of wanting to play football.
Yeah.
Anytime I've ever brought up playing football to Riley, it was, nah, not interested. Don't want to do it. He played one season of flag football. They didn't let him play quarterback, so he wasn't interested.
Your son's not built like a quarterback. He's built like a...
Unless that quarterback is Jared Lorenzen. I don't know if you remember Jared Lorenzen, the fat quarterback from Kentucky.
Yes, I do remember him, now that you put it that way.
Yeah, the fat quarterback from Kentucky. Yeah, but...
Didn't he play arena football?
He played with the Giants for a bit, and then he played arena football, and then he passed away from a massive, probably health-issued heart attack.
Yeah.
Yeah, so...
So what made him want to get back into it? Or actually, get into it.
So actually, he was at the Clemens High School basketball camp. And that's where he goes now. He's a freshman there. And I think the second day of camp, the football coaches cornered him because he is a big kid.
He's a baby-faced man.
Right. A baby face and a baby-brained man.
But definitely a man.
Yeah, definitely the body of a grown man.
Maybe still the coordination of a child.
Yeah, definitely the coordination of a what is a fawn?
A fawn?
Yeah.
Baby deer?
You ever seen a fawn try to walk right out of
the imagine room? A 240-pound fawn.
Yeah, he's 6'1", about 225.
And how old is
he? He's 14 years old.
That's what we call a breeder.
That's
Are you guys?
Yeah.
You and mom, breeders.
Yeah, breeders. We're breeding these beasts.
Your baby's mother birthed a grown man. Yes, and he's just evolving like a Pokemon character.
Standing next to me, he does not look misplaced anymore. He looks like he belongs and is definitely a walker. But
Riley used to look up to me.
You know,
and now I look up to him. I want to grow up.
Yeah, I want to grow up to be like Riley.
To be like Riley.
So he got cornered by these coaches, and one of them told him something like, I better see you at the football camp in a couple weeks. And Riley was like, hey, you know, let me think about it, whatever. So talks to us about it. Everybody involved agreed that if he wants to play, we'll play, you know.
Yeah.
So everyone's on board, and I ask him one day, and he tells me, I already told the coaches I wasn't interested. And I was like, oh, okay. So about a week, probably less than a week before this football camp, he wakes up one day and he goes, I think I want to try football. And I go, are you serious? And he goes, yeah. He goes, I think I want to play. And I said, okay, so here's the plan. I will sign you up for this football camp at Schertz Clemens High School next week. If you like it, we'll do what we need to do to get you started.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't like it, you went to football camp, you tried it, cool. No big deal.
Yep.
And so sign him up. He goes Monday. He said he liked it. He went in wanting to play defense, didn't really care much for playing offense because they knew they were going to put him on the offensive line.
Mm-hmm.
And so I told him, you know, your Uncle Josh, my brother, was an All-American tight end in college, Division III. I said his senior year he moved to offensive tackle. They did away with the tight ends, but they did not want Josh to transfer out. Because Josh was not only a receiving tight end, he could block. He's strong. My brother's strong.
Yeah.
And so they moved him to offensive tackle. And my brother has made the statement before, if I knew how much fun playing offensive tackle was, I would have started that in high school. He goes, I had so much fun, much more fun playing tackle than I did tight end.
You don't hear those words often.
Right.
Skilled.
Right. I don't want to play a skilled position. I'd prefer to play, you know, in with the dogs. So I tell Riley this, and he's like, oh, okay, Dad, you know, whatever.
I thought I played the most fun line position, snapping the ball.
Well, yeah.
I mean.
So now we're on Tuesday, day two of this camp, and he gets in the car afterwards after I pick him up, and he goes, we start helmets on Monday, next Monday. And I go, we do? And he goes, yeah, I'm going to play football. I said, oh, you're having fun, huh? He goes, yeah, I'm still loving defense more, yada, yada, yada. So I was like, okay, cool. So camp is over. Now he's in fall camp.
Mm-hmm.
The actual practices, helmets. He's excited about everything. Like first day helmets, next day helmets. Next day, dad, shoulder pads tomorrow. A couple days later, dad, full pads. Super excited.
Mm.
So I'm like, yeah, okay, cool. In the back of my mind, I am trying to figure out how to ease the blow of, okay, maybe he makes B team. How do I?
Yeah.
Okay, you know what? You've never played football before. You made B team. You're a big kid. You need to learn, you know, whatever, whatever. And so I tell him, I said, do you know when Mike Evans, he's a wide receiver for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
Mm-hmm.
I said, do you know when he started playing football? No. His junior year in high school.
Hmm.
And now he's a pro.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of,
yeah.
You know, so that's kind of where I was headed. So fast forward to a Monday about a month ago, I guess, because they're 4 weeks into the season. Yeah, about a month ago. I get a email or something on the phone that your child will find out what team he made today. And so I'm all day long. I'm like, okay, how do I make
prepare
this
prepare for this?
Yeah, how do I make this kid feel better? And so I go to pick him up, and you know, Riley kind of walks kind of naturally mm-hmm. slumped over mm-hmm. anyway. So with football, we have noticed that his posture is a lot better.
Huh.
So he's walking more upright. I think CrossFit helped with that a little bit.
Yeah, I was going to ask if that was part of the...
Yeah.
If CrossFit was part of the football thing or if football was part of the CrossFit thing.
I think CrossFit was intended for basketball.
Ah.
But now it has translated into he loves going to the weight room after practice.
Good.
So...
He's got his energy up.
So anyways, he comes out of practice that day, that Monday, that he finds out what team he's going to make. And he has... reverted back
mm-hmm.
to slumped over,
mm-hmm.
kind of head down, not his usual jog to the car. And I said, oh, this little turd made B team. I can tell.
Mm-hmm.
So he gets in the car. Hey, Dad. Hey, boy. Guess what? I said, what? I said, you okay? I said, did you make B team? No. I made A team. Like, suckered me, like, pulled me in.
Gotcha.
Pulled me in. Man, when I tell you, I have never been more proud of this boy
mm-hmm.
in my life. Never
for
played.
For getting you or for making the team?
Both. Got me, pulled a me on me, and made a team. So, you know, tell everybody. Molly, of course, is beside herself,
yep.
excited. I tell the family, and the response is literally, he's a walker. What did you expect? Type thing. And I'm like, that's fair.
Yeah.
You know, because Kelsey, my oldest younger sister,
mm-hmm.
was an All-American softball player
mm-hmm.
At St. Mary's.
Okay.
I don't know if she still does, but she held hitting records at the school.
Wow.
For... I mean, if they're not, if she doesn't hold them anymore, she held them for years.
Yeah, yeah.
My other sister, Amy, is 6'1". She's a basketball player. I don't know that she ever really cared that much about sports. She was good at softball. She could hit. Her coordination is definitely a doe or a fawn out of the womb. So she does. She's very clumsy. But I think if she actually cared about the sports that she played, she would have been great too. Because 6'1".
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, you're built for anything.
Could have done something with that, but
that's awesome. Man.
You know, whatever. So good for Riley. Proud of that boy. But we're not here to talk about football or sports or anything else. We're here to talk about music. This is Music Unapologetically. And we got to get into something that we haven't done before, that we have been chastised about because we don't do this nearly enough. But you invited us to a Florida Gators watch party.
Yes.
A couple weeks ago.
Yep.
Travis, Florida alum, cheerleader. I don't know if he ever had any run-ins, romantic or otherwise, with Aaron Hernandez, but was at the school.
Aaron once.
When that weirdo was there.
One time. He was not very social with the rest of the team. Well, at least the ones that I'd
That you were. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So
maybe one time in passing.
Yeah.
But
how did that go? I don't think
it was more of just like a, hey, what's up, man? Kind of a head nod, handshake. Yeah. And then he probably went off and killed someone. So.
Yeah. Went off and killed somebody.
Or had just, I mean, you know, timelines are weird.
Told Urban about it, let Urban sweep it under the rug for him and on with life. But so you invite us to this little watch party at the Anchor Bar. And on the way to the watch party, just listening to the music. It was pouring rain, so it took a minute to get there because 1604 was
flooded.
1604 was flooding, so it took a minute to get there. And I had Sirius XM on the radio going in 90s on 9.
Mm-hmm.
Not a station that I listened to very often previous to that, but now I do because of this.
When I had Sirius XM, that was one of the stations that kept my subscription going.
Yeah.
Was 90s on 9.
So the first station I put on is
70s on 7?
No, it's it's the alternative and grunge.
I know what you're talking about.
I can't think of what it's called right now. But that's the one. But yeah. There was something on there that I didn't like. Tom Morello's all over that thing, and I hate Tom Morello. Like, I hate listening to him talk. He's got a show, an hour-long show, and I hate it. It's so, like, here, listen to me in this band.
Nikki now, Sixx has a show on the 90s one.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. In the evenings. Actually, it's on Sundays. Well, it used to be. I don't know if it's still going.
I would probably prefer to listen to that because this whole Tom Morello thing is here. Listen to me with Rage Against the Machine. Now here, listen to me with Audioslave. Now here, listen to me play this guitar for this obscure band that you've never heard of, but it really sucks. But
and he's looking around like, is anyone listening?
Yeah, and it's like, dude, like, okay, you love yourself. And he made a comment one time about Chris Cornell that that's where I went, you know, kind of with my opinion on him. I just wish he wasn't such a good guitarist, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So anyways, listening to that, and Sheryl Crow comes on.
Mm-hmm.
And I literally find myself like looking at like out of the windshield at the rain in a zone singing Sheryl Crow. And I'm like, yo, I don't listen to a whole lot and I don't appreciate a whole lot of female artists, but I like this. I could listen to this. And so I started making a playlist of my favorite females, you know, whatever. And she was definitely on there.
Side note about Sheryl Crow.
Okay.
When I lived in Franklin, Tennessee.
Okay.
Just outside of Nashville,
yep.
I had a patient that was a police officer.
Uh-huh.
Franklin was very well-to-do.
Yeah.
It's where the money made in Nashville lived.
Okay.
And had a cop that was a patient, asked me if he ever had pulled over any celebrities that lived in town. And he said he pulled over Sheryl Crow doing 55 and a 35 in her Prius.
Oh, nice.
And when he called it in, he didn't call in any names or anything. He just called on the plate number. And he said, dispatch paused for a second and said, is this for real?
That's awesome. So as a cop, what do you do?
He said he gave her a warning.
yeah, of course he did. So another more appreciation towards Sheryl Crow, more than just her music. She opened Woodstock 99.
Oh, God.
Like, opened it.
We watched the documentary on that.
The train wreck.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is where I'm going with this.
Yeah.
She opened Woodstock 99.
Mm-hmm. And then got the hell out of there when it started to go downhill.
So I'm a fan of boobs.
Her halter top she had on?
As most guys are, but I am not a fan of perverts.
Perverts.
And perverts.
Preverts.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of perverts hollering from the crowd, show us your tits.
Yeah.
I don't like that.
Yeah.
And I feel like she handled that as perfect as anyone could. Mm-hmm. You're going to pay a lot more to see these than a $100 ticket.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
To get into Woodstock. So.
Great documentary if you haven't.
Oh, yeah. Go watch Trainwreck, the documentary of the 99 Woodstock. It is. Listen, it's probably a vibe that I would get down with right now still today.
Until the fires.
I mean,
I'm surprised only 3 people died.
Yeah. The only thing that I would not be down with that vibe is them gouging everything because,
oh yeah,
you know, you can go to an HEB and get a bottle of water for 99 cents. And they were selling them for what, $8 to $12 there?
Mm-hmm.
That's wild.
After everything had already broken.
Right.
And they were forced.
So
Shania Twain or Sheryl Crow.
Sheryl Crow. And listen, when I think about female artists, a majority of the artists that I would actually listen to are going to be bunched up into like one genre, one era. But there's one. Actually, there's two. There's two females that really stick out. One is not in this era. That's from the 60s, Janis Joplin. Every time I listen to Janis Joplin, I listen to Janis Joplin with my dad. I listen to it by myself.
Mm-hmm.
To me, she is the queen of female, I'll say rock.
Fair enough.
I would throw her up there, the queen of female music, period. Just depending on what you actually like, because you could go with Janis Joplin if you're into that. You could go with Whitney Houston if you're into that. You could go with Aretha Franklin and
Ella Fitzgerald
and
Donna Summer.
Right. You could go in that direction. I mean, there's so many directions to go.
Well, same thing with the guys. It's like saying, is Elvis the king of rock or is Chuck Berry the king of rock? You know, or is Buddy Holly the king
Buddy
of
Holly.
Rock?
You know, so like, if Buddy Holly doesn't die in the car crash, he's the king of rock and roll and...
Plane crash.
What did I say?
Car crash.
Plane crash. If he doesn't die in the plane crash, he is definitely the king of rock and roll. And Elvis is he's just Elvis, you know?
Watch that movie too.
Is it good?
Oh, God.
So Janis Joplin,
mm-hmm.
you know, up there, whatever. Then when I'm listening to other females, it's definitely going to be, and I started making this playlist, it was definitely a 90s female list.
Yeah.
Because the females that you have today, I'm not into that. I'm not.
Some of them.
I'm not into.
There's a lot of like radio hype behind females today, and the ones that. It's funny, I feel like the ones that are the best female vocalists now aren't doing new things because they did so much like a couple decades ago.
Right.
That it's like if Michael were still alive, like he wouldn't need to make any more music because it's like.
Right.
You've done all you need to do.
Right.
You
know, absolutely.
We're good just replaying your stuff.
Right. You know? Absolutely. 100%.
I don't need Celine Dion to make another album.
Right.
You know?
So I've had this conversation with the old school rappers. I don't need Method Man to make a new album. I don't need Wu-Tang to get in the... I don't need them in making an album.
Mm-mm.
If they do, I'm going to listen to it, yes. Ghostface, and that was actually... Ghostface came out with an album a couple years ago, and that's what brought this conversation on. I don't need Ghostface in the studio right now making Mm-mm. a 12-track album. I don't, because what he did in the 90s...
was enough.
Is good enough.
Yeah.
For me to go back and listen to. So I'm glad you said that.
It's like
that.
Christmas albums. People just need to stop making Christmas albums.
Oh, my God.
We got enough. Like, all the Christmas songs that need to be made were made.
I hate Christmas anyway, so I don't want to hear Method Man or...
DMX's.
You know, DMX's Rudolph, version of Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
Although it was a really good version of it. So, let's do a back and forth here.
Okay.
So, you give me... Give me a female artist that you really like.
Okay, so...
A little bit why, and I'll agree or disagree, and then we can go back and forth for a handful.
So what I want to do real quick is when I think about 90s female artists
mm-hmm.
in the group that I I have selected, and Sheryl Crow is definitely in that group, that genre. There's literally one female that's unequivocally, no debate, number one. 99.9% of people who are into females from the 90s.
Can I guess who you're going to
say? We're going to do it on three.
Okay.
Okay. 99.9% of anybody who knows anything about 90s female music is going to say this name, and we're going to do it on three.
Got
okay.
It.
One, two, three.
Alanis Morissette.
That's it. Absolutely 100. Now, the drop off between one and two, I don't know that it's huge just because we said Alanis Morissette is undebatably number one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't think it's huge because, to be honest, she would be 1A and I would have a 1B as a Nora Jones.
Nora Jones.
Yeah. I love Nora Jones.
I think Nora Jones was good, but I think the celebrity and the popularity was definitely on Alanis' side.
No, absolutely. 100%.
It's kind of like if you got your favorite band or your favorite like lead singer has a secondary band.
Right.
It's just as good, but you just don't know much about it. You know what I mean? Kind of like a...
And there are exceptions to that rule because I like Audioslave more than I like Soundgarden.
Right.
Right there, so there's definitely exceptions to the rule, but I agree with that. Nora Jones for me is more of a nostalgia thing with my dad. My dad loved Nora Jones. I would walk into his office, no matter where it was at, and he would be Bible open, mm-hmm. studying, and Nora Jones playing. Nora Jones is playing in Austin. Phone call from my dad. Hey, let's try to find tickets to Nora Jones, type thing. And so anytime she comes on a playlist or like just randomly on a Apple radio, I'm stopping and listening. I'd love it. And I'll throw her in with the Alanis Morissette, the Sheryl Crows, all of that just because of the era. But I love that what she does. I like her voice more than Alanis Morissette's,
mm-hmm.
just because I like that raspy female voice.
And see,
behind a piano.
I like Alanis more because I like the yodely.
Yeah.
Like that yodely. Just she's the only one that ever sang like that.
Right.
That real twangy uptick at the end, kind of squealy. Singing.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Now I'll say this also. I appreciate Alanis Morissette now, in my 40s. Than I did back in the 90s when I was a teenager, because that Jagged Little Pill,
mm-hmm.
Alanis was a weirdo.
Mm-hmm.
She had that long, stringy, gross hair.
All the music
hair.
Videos were weird.
The music videos were weird. I didn't understand at that time lyrics.
The harmonica.
Right. But
it's cool though, you
listen,
know?
Listen, I can't really say anything about the harmonica because I was a big blues
traveler.
I was about to say,
that's the thing is you had Blues Traveler.
Right.
And then you had Alanis.
Making that popular.
And you're like,
But as you get older and you see Alanis getting older and much more beautiful.
Uh-huh. She's aging well.
She's aging very well. And I feel like her music is aging just as finely as she is.
Well, you got to think now. You think about our parents that were listening to that then when they're our age. And
right.
You're like, this is how they heard it.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I see why my mom liked Alanis.
Yeah.
Even though my mom wasn't a big 90s music fan, I see why she liked Alanis.
I don't know if my dad liked Alanis Morissette or not. I know he liked Sheryl Crow. I know he liked Sheryl Crow a lot.
I feel like Alanis would have been a little too... not polished enough for your old man.
I mean, my dad listened to some weird stuff. So, I mean, I just don't know. I would have to get with one of my sisters to find out if he indeed enjoyed Alanis Morissette. But like I said... she's number one, and 99% of anybody is going to say that as well.
Now, where we deviate is aside from Alanis Morissette in the 90s. Now, granted, her career, mostly 80s and some 90s.
Uh-huh.
And we joke about this person all the time.
Okay.
Well, you hate it. I love it. Is Whitney.
Okay. I don't hate Whitney as a person. I just am not a fan of her music.
Do you know? So let me ask this. Okay.
Okay.
Because we never dived into this. We just pick at each other about it.
Right.
Do you not like Whitney's voice? Do you not like her songs? Do you not like her style? Because on pure vocals alone, her range, her control, like her, like just the power she sings with is incredible.
Okay, so I'll say this, okay, and I'll throw another name out there. You say range. Range doesn't impress me, okay?
Octave range doesn't impress you.
And I'll give you an example of why it annoys me, okay? Mariah Carey.
I knew you were going to say that.
Amazing range.
Mm-hmm.
She can,
mm-hmm.
and it's very, very high pitch. Yep. I don't like that. I'm not, that when you're doing that in a song, oh my God.
But now let me play devil's advocate here.
Okay.
One of the greatest vocalists, period, of all time, also had one of the biggest ranges of all time.
Okay. Freddie Mercury. Okay. But he's not in that high, squeaky, like, oh, that hurts.
Yeah, but Whitney was never a squeaker like Mariah was.
Right.
She sang, when she sang high octaves, it was like a belly diaphragm.
Right.
Like, powerful. Mariah squeals.
I also will say this in regards to the Mariahs and the Whitneys and the Beyoncés. I'm just not into that genre of music.
That's fair.
You know what I mean? Like, I'm not seeking out female R&B, if that's what you call it. You know what I mean?
Do you like neo-soul females? Erykah Badu, Macy Gray.
So that's a whole different, like, And the same thing goes for Macy Gray and Erykah Badu as it goes with Norah Jones. Their raspy voices are gorgeous to me.
Yeah.
Like, I could listen to that to drive in a car, or they can sing me to sleep.
So then
in a good way.
So let me ask this then. One person you and I do agree on.
Uh-huh.
Lauryn Hill.
Absolutely.
Okay.
100%.
Now Lauryn Hill, yes, she covered a few genres.
Right.
But she does have some R&B stuff.
Right.
Do you appreciate her as an R&B singer?
So I appreciate her as an R&B singer because I don't feel like her R&B singing is as R&B-y as the Whitneys and Mariahs and Beyoncés and whatever. It's more of a hip-hop singing type. You know what I mean? Does that make sense?
Yeah, yeah.
Like she's got her songs where she's actually singing.
Yeah.
But she's not like not doing this.
But you like Toni Braxton.
I'm okay with Toni Braxton. I'm okay with Mary J. Blige.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's
she's the queen of R&B.
That's stuff that I'm not going to turn it off if it's on. But I don't know, man. Whitney just didn't ever she just never blew my skirt up, you know. Mm. Same with Mariah.
Liked Mariah in the 90s when she was young and it was like kind of poppy. The song with Boys to Men was huge because they were in it too. But like, I agree with you on that. I never was a massive Mariah fan. And the fact that she is the number one artist for the most single number ones, or if she hasn't been beaten, she still is. Like, that's just very odd to me, and it makes me think, like, that number one spot is kind of tainted with just the era she was in and how music was starting to grow and be disseminated way easier, that she could be the top singles number one female artist. It's just very odd to me.
It was, you know, I put it on Instagram the other day, getting people to tell me there. You like that?
Haven't had it yet.
Oh, okay.
I was seeing how much caffeine was in it.
But, getting people to send me female artists that they like, and Jazz, homeboy Jazz, texted and said, old Mariah, pre-crazy Mariah, 90s Mariah. And I was like, oh, okay. Like, I don't see you jamming.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see you jamming early 90s Mariah. It's weird. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, to each his own, you know, of course. So Whitney, I mean, When we did the top 50 with Wes and Jazz of all the rappers, I threw some names out there just as respect names. Snoop Dogg, not a big Snoop Dogg fan, after Doggy Style, but he was on my list as a respect as a respect addition. So I mean, if I had to make a list and I had to rank them, which I don't want to do,
mm-hmm.
I would throw Whitney on there as a respect addition.
Okay.
I would not put Beyonce on my list.
I wouldn't either.
I wouldn't put Mariah on my list. I wouldn't put any of these idiots today on my list. Because I still feel like music is dead mm-hmm. right now.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah. So, anyways, so that's the top of my list. Give me a.
Now, are we doing singers or female artists?
No, we're doing artists because, and I'm glad you said that. Okay?
Because I like Queen Latifah and Chaka Khan.
Okay, so I'm into that. Yeah, no, we're doing artists, not just singers. And I'll say this too, bands. I'm not, okay, and I'll say, I should have prefaced with this. I should have started with this. I'm not into females trying to rock my ears off.
Yeah, me either. Cyndi Lauper?
No, not even that. Like, I'll go a little further, okay? Hole.
Don't even know who that is.
That's Courtney Love.
Oh, God, no. No,
I don't want...
No, you're trying to be your husband.
I don't want females trying to be rock stars. I want you to sing...
So you don't like the Cranberries?
I love the Cranberries. That's...
What about the Bengals?
Not so much into the Bengals. And again, there's exceptions to all the rules. I don't want to listen to Hole. I don't want to listen to Luscious Jackson. I don't want to listen to all that. However, I think Shirley Manson has a great voice for a rock band.
Yeah.
Garbage.
Yeah.
And then you said it, Dolores from the Cranberries has a very, very beautiful voice.
And are you familiar with Ginger?
No.
Ginger is a like heavy metal band uh-huh. that has a redheaded lead singer that's a female, and she is.
I bet she's crazy.
Incredible.
I bet she's crazy.
She's incredible.
If she's redhead, Ginger. Yeah, of course. But Dolores O'Deirdrin from the Cranberries,
yep.
She died a few years ago.
Really?
Yeah. And the Cranberries are one of my, I mean, I listened to them in the 90s. I bought albums of the Cranberries. After she died, and actually, I say after she died, I think last year, they put out a Remembering Dolores album.
Mm-hmm.
You should go listen to it. It's pretty good. Mm-hmm. But I can definitely get into that with the Cranberries and Garbage, but that's where it stops. I'm not trying to get into the hard, you know, the harder, as hard as a female can rock, you know, type.
What about Tracy Chapman?
I love Tracy Chapman. I think she's super...
Instrumentalist and vocalist.
I think she's super duper underrated.
For sure.
And I think Fast Car is one of my top favorite songs ever.
Mm-hmm.
I love that song. As cliche as it sounds and as one-hit wonder as she was, of course, her one hit is one of my favorite songs. I love Tracy Chapman.
On the same line as Tracy Chapman, I think somebody that's underappreciated, they really only had one big song, too, was Michelle Indicello. That sang Wild Nights.
I think if I heard
cover,
I've heard that. Okay.
Yeah, she had a great voice. Very Tracy Chapman-esque, but deeper.
One that I don't like admitting from the 90s that I do like is Sarah McLachlan.
Yeah, she had a couple, you know.
She had a couple of those.
I think that I think I would like Sarah McLachlan more if she didn't do that ASPCA commercials.
That's exactly where I was going with that, dude. The ASPCA makes me so mad that they picked her. Because I wanted to keep on liking her.
What about TLC?
I love TLC. I love that Weezer chose to cover a TLC song. That's two groups that I love so much coming together.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not purposely maybe on TLC's part, but they killed it. You know, mm-hmm. It's funny listening to a dude sing those female lyrics,
mm-hmm.
you know, but I mean, I would expect nothing less from Weezer.
When I was young, I thought it was like my mission in life to figure out who Jason Waterfall was and why they wanted him to go.
They didn't want him to go.
Well, in my head, it was Jason Waterfall.
Duh.
I was like, who's this guy and why do they want him to go so bad?
Man, if I knew you back in the day, I would have never thought you would have been a doctor.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's like Jimmy, you know?
Yeah.
I didn't know he was gay.
Oh.
Excuse me while I kiss this guy. Yeah.
Yeah.
Then I got older and realized he wasn't gay. I was just an idiot.
And he was kissing the sky.
He was kissing the sky.
Yeah.
What about, which direction do you want to go? Do you want to go forward or backward?
Let's go Let's go backward.
Okay. So let's go 50s to 70s.
See, that's where... Okay, so 50s, I don't know. I don't know much.
So, all right, so
60s would be Janis.
50s, the only... Like, your big 50s artists, and for females, they were so underground because... It just wasn't
just that,
widely
that
was, accepted. But, right. Like, Big Mama Thornton.
I don't know.
That's saying Hound Dog. Okay. That's where Elvis got Hound Dog from.
Really?
Yeah.
Big Mama Thornton was nothing but a Hound Dog?
She sang Hound Dog.
Wow.
Yep.
Okay.
So, she was a very big pioneer in the, like, kind of the Ray Charles era.
Okay.
You know, she was that, like, small venue. Just, and she had, you talking about raspy voice, that... Real soulful, like, and I say this with all respect, that soulful big black woman, just yeah. that, you know, that's her.
Okay.
Like, that's her. She's that woman.
Okay.
Yeah. So she was a boss. And she probably paved the way for a lot more female artists in the 60s and 70s, like Aretha, Ella Fitzgerald, like a lot of these powerful black female vocalist.
Okay.
She's the one that was like the foundation for them to build on.
I want to do something real quick. Now that you have mentioned big, strong black women with big, strong voices, I don't know if I have ever told you about this band. But I'm going to play a little something right here. Let's do this right here. Let me make sure my volume is not going to kill everybody. Oh, no, no. That's not what I want.
While you look that up, I just want to... I'm not going to play anything. I just want to tell people about... There's a girl named Layla Hathaway.
Okay.
Modern day jazz vocalist.
Okay. We can get into
she's
some jazz vocalist.
She's a polyphonic singer.
Oh, nice.
And if you've never heard her sing polyphonic, there's a video of her with her band just doing like a song, and then they get into, you know, kind of a breakdown, you know, kind of a, you know, a scat kind of singing, and she sings polyphonic.
Okay.
Hits two notes at the same time, and it's unreal.
You ever heard the Alabama Shakes?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Love her.
Yeah.
She is a big, strong black woman with a gorgeous voice. I love this. I could listen to her sing every day, and I do. She actually goes on playlists. And when I was making actually my list of all these, I absolutely forgot about it until you said that.
My ex, when I lived in Nashville, her dad was in a like Americana band. And he played the washboard, and one of the guys, the lead guitarist, played the steel acoustic.
Okay.
And a saw. He played a bow. Their lead singer was a strong, big black female singer, and she would belt out. Oh my God!
That's awesome.
She would, and she had one of those old school microphones. It's like the mono mics.
Yeah.
So when she would sing and it would come through this, if you felt like you were just completely sent back to the 50s.
Yeah.
And we're listening to this woman sing like in a dark club. It was incredible.
That's awesome.
So incredible.
I like that a lot.
I wish I could remember their band because they like their music's out. Like we could find it. I bet I could find it.
Yeah.
You'd love them, man.
Yeah. I like that. So, I feel like in the way she dresses to her concerts mm-hmm. and everything, she definitely belongs in the 50s. Like, just a dress
mm-hmm.
that you would see, you know, Wally Cleaver's mom wearing,
mm-hmm.
you know,
yep.
type thing. I love it. I love it. So, yeah, 50s, I'm not super familiar with it.
So, Etta James she's more 60s, I think, her and Aretha.
Yeah, so 60s, you can definitely get a better conversation out of me,
mm-hmm.
Probably more geared toward Janis, of course, Janis Joplin. I feel like if she did not pass away so early, she would definitely be the queen of female artists.
There was somebody that we didn't talk about in the 90s we just got to touch on.
Who's that?
Aaliyah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, no, we'll make our way back.
Okay.
I promise.
Okay.
The 70s.
The 70s for me, when I think of like the top female vocals, like I lean way towards disco.
Okay.
Like Donna Summer, the Supremes are more 60s, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, Donna Summer for me is like, when I think of the quintessential 70s female vocalist, I don't go to rock because there was so many, just Southern and, that classic rock was just all men. But I think about like Donna Summer, like Diana Ross.
Right.
And I just think like that to me is the 70s female for.
Okay. I agree with that. But if I'm going to the 70s, when I get to the 70s, I'm thinking Heart.
Okay.
Barracuda.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yep.
That's kind of my direction in, because I mean, that's the music I grew up with, is the classic rock.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when it was, it doesn't exist anymore, but when I was younger, the classic rock station was 104.5 KZEP.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's, you know, they're mixing in Barracuda and Heart and all that with that music. Also in the 70s, and this is another one that we are going to disagree on, probably till the day we die.
Oh, God, not again.
Yes. Fleetwood Mac. So the first time we ever talked about it, she was a frog, and now she's apparently a goat.
She was a goat from the South Park episode.
She is the goat of females in the 70s. You're right. Greatest of all time.
So here's a quick list of like top 70s females. Just okay. I mean, that know a Pat lot Benatar. Of them cross generations. You have Diana Ross, Olivia uh-huh. Newton-John, rest in peace. Kate Bush, which a lot of her stuff is more 80s, but they'll give it to her. Ella Fitzgerald, Barbara Streisand, Donna Summer, Aretha, Linda Ronstadt, which we talked about off camera. Mm-hmm. I think her biggest stuff was more 90s.
Okay.
Dolly, definitely big 70s.
Okay, yeah.
Gloria Estefan, Bonnie Tyler, Patti LaBelle, Cass Elliott, Gloria Gaynor, Joan Jett.
Joan Jett, there you go.
Yeah.
Cyndi Lauper, was Bjork. She 80s?
Cyndi Lauper was 80s, yeah.
Okay.
That song, We Are the World.
Yeah.
Watching Michael Jackson react to her when she started singing.
I've never seen it.
Oh my God, it's so funny. It was like a behind the scenes of them making that video, and she comes in with this like, wow, 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 and like Michael's like.
I don't know that I could ever take Michael seriously if he was ever calling anybody a weirdo. You know what I mean? Like, man, have you ever met so-and-so? They are strange. And I'd be like, what's your barometer of strange, dude? Because you are my barometer. That's like
the pot calling the kettle crazy.
Right? Like, you're a part of my barometer of strange, buddy.
I use you as the example. Are you stranger or less strange than Michael? Right. What decade? 90s Michael. Oh, yes. Uh-oh. Much, much less strange. So yeah, 70s.
70s, yeah. Classic rock is I mean that's the direction I would be.
Yeah.
I would be going. The Fleetwood Mac, the Heart.
Yeah.
The Pat Benatar. Is she 70s?
She's more 80s.
More 80s, okay.
Which I mean is a perfect segue.
Yeah.
80s, Pat Benatar.
Pat Benatar, Cyndi Lauper.
The chick from the Eurythmics.
I don't remember the Eurythmics.
I can't remember her name.
Sing the Eurythmics song.
And I run, I run so far away.
Wait, that's a girl.
The redheaded one, yeah.
Oh, wow. She's okay.
Red short hair, yeah.
And
then you got your, you know, Pat Benatar, I think, is the queen of...
Of the 80s.
Of the 80s. Just, I mean, the woman was an opera singer turned rock.
Okay.
And when I saw her sing in concert with Journey and Loverboy, and she walks out on stage, she wasn't even the first set. She just walked out on stage, sang the national anthem.
And walked off.
And walked back off until her set. And everybody in the crowd was like, oh, that's how we're going to start this? All right.
Okay. Good ticket purchase.
Boss. Pat Benatar is such a badass.
Yeah.
80s. Yeah. Let's see. Like your Cyndi Lauper.
Yeah.
80s.
Listen, we love 80s music, but 80s females.
Chaka Khan. 80s. Late 80s, early 90s. Chaka Khan.
Yeah. Not.
I'm trying to think who else is big 80s. Let's see.
Big 80s. Nope.
And a lot of these names from before are going to cross over because they were more 70s and 80s. Sinead O'Connor, Celine Dion started in the 80s.
Uh-huh.
Alanis actually started in the 80s.
Was that Jagged Little Pills was 80s?
No. This she got her start singing in the 80s.
Oh, got it.
Dolly obviously crossed over. Stevie crossed over. Janet Jackson was before she kind of went big.
Yeah.
Paula Abdul.
Oh, good one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Great performer.
Yeah.
Decent voice.
Decent voice. But
she was a great performer. You know, I think she was, I feel like Paula Abdul, I think her biggest contribution to music is she is like the Pink before Pink was Pink. Like performer.
Oh, man.
Dancer, big concerts, cool music videos with like a lot of like stuff going on. Like I feel like she paved the way for like what Madonna was trying to do and like the kind of like the, like I'm so different that like I'm on the fringe, and Paula Abdul was like still in the main, like in the spotlight, but was still very like
Pink.
Big, you know? Yeah.
I think Paula Abdul was most popular just because she was so good looking.
She was very good looking. Still is. You're beautiful.
She looks plastic now, dude.
Kylie Minogue.
Don't know who that is.
She was pretty big.
These are still 80s.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I was a Paula Abdul fan. I think I had a poster on my wall at one point.
The Bangles.
Yeah.
Pat Benatar, Chaka Khan. Whitney, of course. Tina Turner.
Tina Turner. That's one that I've been waiting. Yeah. I didn't. Yeah. Okay.
80s. Yeah, she was big 80s.
She would definitely be up there as if you're trying to make a king of rock and roll or a queen.
Mm-hmm.
Tina Turner would definitely be up there.
I think Tina is to the 80s what Alanis was to the 90s. Her Pat Benatar. I mean, depending on what genre you want to go towards.
Yeah, I would definitely lean toward Pat Benatar, but.
Yeah, 1A, 1B.
Yeah, yeah. 90s. This is where we can have a whole episode. Yeah.
I mean, we covered a lot of the good ones.
A lot of the good ones, but there's still a lot of good ones that we haven't covered. Jewel, yeah. Underrated.
Very underrated.
Fiona Apple, underrated.
Underrated for sure.
Tori Amos, underrated. Mm-hmm. Here's one that is definitely up there with the Alanis and the Norah Jones for me, and that's No Doubt and Gwen Stefani. And I think she can stand alone because her genre, I mean, she was the punk girl. And I'll put her up there with Pink because Pink was kind of in that same genre as well.
I struggle with Gwen Stefani, not because I don't like her. Because when her stuff would come on the radio, like, it was catchy, you'd listen to it, and she's a great singer, she's a great performer, but I never sought her music out. It was like, if it's on, like, I dig it, and people put it on, I don't tell them to change it, but, I wasn't I gotta go find the newest Gwen Stefani song, or the newest No Doubt song.
I did.
Know? You did?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I liked it, but it wasn't everything
for me. It was actually, it was actually the No Doubt, I'm Just a Girl that,
yeah, I mean, that song is it's a great song.
But then she went solo,
mm-hmm.
which was upsetting to me. She had a couple of songs that were pretty good, but one that she sampled, Biggie, that Luxurious song,
mm-hmm.
That sucked me back in.
Yeah.
Because that Banana song.
Yeah, it was rough.
Yeah, that was a bad time.
That was rough.
For that. Yeah, that was definitely a bad time for Gwen. But then she sampled Biggie, and I'm back. But I'll definitely go back and listen to No Doubt still to this day, just because they were great. I mean, that's stuff that was on the radio when I was growing up.
You know, that same 90s, it's where you start to get into, like, popularity versus talent, you know, because that's, you know, you and I have talked about how like the 90s was kind of the last frontier of good music,
good
and
music,
the 2000s
yeah.
started kind of killing it off. But you got some artists that were late 90s, you uh-huh. know, like you get into your Christinas and your Britneys.
Yeah, I you know? Didn't want to bring them up.
I know, but you got to. You also get into like early Shakira and Jennifer Lopez.
Talk about sounding like a frog.
Yeah.
Shakira.
Jennifer Lopez?
No, it's Shakira.
No, I'm saying Jennifer Lopez.
Oh, Jennifer, yeah, I mean.
You know, there's this, like, weird conspiracy theory about some artists in the music space that they aren't actually singing their songs. They're just a figurehead, like a face, because the music industry recognized, like, say, like, so the examples are, recently, I don't know if you've heard, but if you slow down Nicki Minaj, it's Jay-Z. Not kind of sounds like Jay-Z, It's Jay-Z.
Okay.
If you slow down Post Malone or speed up Post Malone, it's Justin Bieber. So like there's this conspiracy theory that Hollywood will find, or you know, the music industry will have one good artist, but then to create another big successful artist, they can just pitch up or down their music and just put a face on it.
Yeah.
But if you, I'm sorry, if you listen to,
so are there videos on YouTube that actually slows it down for you?
Yeah. I'll show you one.
Yeah. Because the Nicki Minaj and Jay-Z, that's intriguing. Super intriguing. Okay, so I don't know. Maybe that's just coincidence when you slow it down and computerize it so much, but I don't. I don't. I, chimpanzees is hating, but I take it all in stride. I, chimpanzees is hating, but I take it all in stride. Anyway, Brittany, listen, I don't. Turn that off.
I'm trying. I'm trying.
Listen, I don't know that Jay-Z would get in and sing some of those lyrics.
Why not?
I mean, why?
More money.
I don't know, man. I don't know.
I'll believe anything in the music industry nowadays. I mean, honestly.
So who are musicians selling their soul to these days? Is it Jay-Z?
Besides the devil?
Yeah.
Dude, it's like such a big thing, man. These artists are so vocal about it now. Like, oh, I like went to these parties and they made me sign a you know, non-disclosure agreement.
Right.
To give my phone at the front door.
And yeah.
They're starting to talk more, man.
Yeah, that's
Alicia Keys.
Yo, okay, so I wrote her down. I was wondering when we were gonna get to her. I can listen to her music all day long, and I can look at her.
She's beautiful.
Oh my, yes.
Alicia Keys. Let me reword this because I was gonna say it the one way, and I want to say it the other way.
Okay.
John Legend is the male Alicia Keys.
In regards to
just talent and like when I think about like piano vocalists,
okay,
I think about those two, and okay. I feel like I like her more than I like him.
Oh, I like her.
I mean, I love John Legend, don't get me wrong, but I like Alicia Keys.
I like some of John Legend.
Alicia Keys is the original,
right? But you, man, but then I get on the internet and Instagram and all this stuff, and I see her standing next to Swiss Beats, and I'm like, man. What a waste.
You remember Maya and Brandy?
Yeah. And Monica. Boy,
and Monica.
Yeah.
That boy is mine.
Monica and Brandy did a Versus recently, didn't they?
Did they?
Yeah. I want to say a few months ago.
Can we name like the top 90s female?
Our own?
Besides Atlantis?
Our
different
own?
Different genre. See if you can guess it. Hip hop.
Who, yours? Missy Elliott. Yeah. Yeah. I know that.
Yours is Lauryn Hill. I know that.
Mine is definitely Lauryn Hill. But with a splash of Missy and Trina and
Lil' Kim
and Eve and Queen Latifah.
DeBrat.
Yeah. Like those are real female rappers.
Yeah.
This crap that these kids listen to today, they're all hoes. That's all it is. It's them. Publicizing,
it's shock value.
It's publicizing their sluttiness.
You know, Katie and I laughed about this when we were watching the Elvis movie.
Uh-huh.
How he faced all of this like legal turmoil because he was shaking his hips while he was on stage.
Right.
And I was like, how funny is it that 60 years later, you got girls singing about wet ass?
Yeah. Horrible. Horrible.
And the music videos are like softcore porn.
I feel bad for our kids.
The youths.
Yeah, I feel bad for the youths because they think the music that they're getting today is
music
golden.
No, they just think it's music.
And when they get to be our age, they're going to be telling their kids, man, you should have heard what we were listening to. You should have, like, oh, man, you should hear Lil Yachty. He was...
There's some funny videos that were popping up online of, like, people dress like old, like people that like young people dressed up as like grandmas and like in their deathbed, like put on my favorite song from when I was a girl, and it starts playing Nicki Minaj, like Cardi B.
That's horrible. That's horrible, dude. Like, yeah, these kids today.
Back in my day,
they just have no idea. So the other day, when I was at work, back in the kitchen area, they like to put on loud music, whatever. And so one of the girls was going up to start the speaker, and I walked up to her and I said, can I have the aux cord first? Can I pick the first song?
Mm-hmm.
And she goes, yeah, sure. So of course I went to Method Man. I put on What the Blood Clot, and none of these kids understood what was happening. One guy who was a little older walked in and go, oh, Method Man? And I was like, yeah.
Thank God.
Yeah. And everybody else was like, yo, who gave this guy the aux cord? And I was like, oh, no. I got to go.
You're going to take your belt off.
I got to start smacking everybody, spanking everybody. Yeah. So, I don't know, man. I think females do hold their right place in...
So, Madonna.
No.
No?
Nope. I didn't even want to bring her up. Because every list that I saw that was actually ranking had Madonna as number one, and it made me mad. And
well, it's because, I mean, you got to look at what they're going on. Probably going off of record sales.
But she was doing the same thing back in the 80s and 90s that I was just complaining about. Like, you were publicizing your hoeness.
Yeah, well, I mean, every generation has one.
And
right?
I guess that might have been around the time where the whole big advertising sex sells slogan came, and Madonna, well, Madonna
Cyrus,
jumped on it.
Miley Cyrus was this generation's Madonna. Yeah, and every generation's got one.
There's just every generation's got your trash. Mm-hmm. You know, it just seems more prevalent now because of the kids who are more willing to accept that trash as actual music. Whereas if Nicki Minaj and Cardi B and all of them were in the 90s going up against Missy Elliott and Trina and all of them, they'd have got booed off the stage. Mm-hmm. Hands down, 100%. There's no debate that Eve would have outperformed Cardi B in the 90s.
No, for sure.
And Missy Elliott would have outperformed Nicki Minaj. Mm-hmm. And Missy and Queen Latifah would have been outperforming that hoe from Houston, what's her name, the Stallion.
Oh, Megan
girl.
Stallion. Yeah. What about maybe lesser known, like country and like American, like folk singers, like Amy Grant.
Amy Grant was good. I liked Amy Grant. Debbie Gibson.
Yeah. Take away the drama, okay, and all the political nonsense.
Nonsense. Okay.
The Chicks.
When they were the Dixie Chicks, yeah, yes, absolutely.
I love their song.
Now,
I liked they had great harmony.
They did.
The fact that they played instruments was, I mean, they were all incredible guitarists, their fiddle player,
right?
Incredible.
But if you're gonna talk country, it's Reba.
Reba,
absolutely.
Wynonna Judd.
Reba is definitely the George Strait of the female.
Yeah, I agree.
The female side of country.
Yeah, Wynonna Judd.
I think Wynonna
Martina
Judd
McBride.
Yeah. Faith
Hill.
Hill. Yeah. She was 90s, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tim McGraw's wife. I think who else? Very good. Like, country?
Country, that's...
I liked... There were. I had a little bit more leeway, I think, on the countryside for women than I did other genres. Just because they, you know, they could tell stories really well. And you had Dolly that kind of paved the way for that.
Yeah.
Patsy Cline.
Listen, I'll tell you a funny story and we'll close with this. Patsy Cline, my mother had a CD when I was younger, and I'm talking like third, fourth, fifth grade, whatever. And she would tell us to clean our room, we wouldn't. She would tell us to clean our room, we wouldn't. She would tell us to clean our room, we wouldn't. Mm-hmm. And she came in one day with that Patsy Cline CD, and she put it on our boombox. I'm not turning this off until this room is to my liking. Get up and clean your room. And I don't think I've ever done a deep clean so quick in my life to get that trash off of my boombox. as I did that day. But no disrespect to Patsy Cline, it's just not what I'm looking
not
for.
At that, not at not, that, not that
not,
age.
Not at 12 years old. Imagine Riley listening to Patsy Cline. But that was me. Anyways, these women, I feel like they need more respect. Maybe we'll start incorporating them more into these music episodes as they should be, where they belong. But anyways, dude, we're right at an hour, actually. 1 hour and 13 seconds.
Well, you know, I do want to point out that it is 2022 and that we cannot assume that these are all women.
Anyways, with that, we'll catch y'all later.